Welcome to the Madison County Public Library Senior Wellness Series. Today is stretches and safety, and it's about fall prevention, not falling, and what you can do to avoid falling. And instead of Leah Van Winkle doing the yoga, Leah's out of town, scheduled out of town, and her good friend Emily is here, and Emily is from Mind, Body, and Soul in Berea, and she's going to be doing the soft chair yoga today with an emphasis on how to prevent falling. And then after that will be Rhett Kenny, chiropractor from Berea, talking about ways to prevent falling and how to strengthen your feet and your ankles and your knees. And then next month will be have an herbalist talking about all the different things. You know, can't remember her name. I don't think so. But it will be in the calendar. I think it is in the calendar. It's online right now, but it will be in the paper calendar soon. But it is online right now. So welcome, and we'll edit all of that I don't know stuff out. No one likes to say I don't know on because I'm having a brain thing.
Being a political way now.
No. I think it's the worst thing for anybody that works in a library to say I don't know. I think they should say I will find out. Yes, I will find out. But I'm having a mind. It is, so stop it. Questions. Go for it, Emily.
Okay. So like she said, my name is Emily La Douceur, and I live in Berea. And so the focus for today, I'm hoping for you all, is to strengthen your core quite a bit. And you wouldn't think that you can do a lot of that in a chair, but I'm going to show you a few techniques. We'll do some modified yoga sequences using the chair. At one point we will get up and we'll use the chair for balance. So I'll show you some things you can do at home. Okay, so let's just start by coming up to the edge of your chair. Feet flat on the floor. Sit up straight, elongate your spine. Close your eyes and let's take a few deep breaths together. Inhale into your belly. And exhale. Inhale. And exhale. Inhale. And exhale. Now this type of breathing I want you to do throughout the practice. So if I remind you to breathe, that's what I'm talking about. We're going to take our arms down by our sides and inhale, come up over our heads, clasping our hands and using our pointer fingers to stretch to the sky. We're going to inhale, and on the exhale, we're going to lean to one side. Hold it here and breathe. Inhale, come up and stretch to the sky. Exhale. Inhale up. Stretch again. Back to the side. Inhale up. Exhale down. Exhale down, bring your hands behind your back. We're going to clasp those fingers. If you can, straighten them out. Poke that chest out. Bring the chin up. Inhale. And on the exhale, release and roll forward. On the inhale, we're going to look up, arch our back. And exhale, bring the belly into the spine, roll forward. Inhale, look up. exhale, roll forward. One more set. Inhale, look up. Exhale, roll forward. And then come to a neutral spine. We're going to take our right hand. You're already feeling warm, right?
I like that. And that's the first one I've done. I liked.
Well, all right then. Right hand over our left knee. We're going to twist back using our chair. Gaze over your left shoulder. Twisting your spine just gently. Don't overdo it. You should feel a stretch, a slight one in your neck and in your back. Inhale. And exhale, bring it forward. Everything we do on one side for balance, we do on the other. So left hand to the right knee. Inhale. And exhale, bring it back to the center. We're going to bring our arms out to our sides. We're going to flip up one palm and reach in that direction until you feel a stretch in your outer hip. And then bring it back to the center. Make sure you're breathing. And bring it back to the center. Remember I told you we're going to be working that core in ways you didn't think you could in a chair? This is what I'm talking about. You're working your whole core right now and stretching your outer hip. Turning that palm up is just helping you keep your balance. And bring it back to the center. Now let's make some small circles. We're really going to warm up our shoulders here. You might feel a little burn. And go in the other direction. Then we're going to make bigger ones. Right hand up over our head, and we're just going to rest it above our left ear. Now we're not going to pull, we're just going to turn our head slightly down to the side, and then with our other hand we're going to stretch our fingers to the floor just to get a light stretch in the neck. Not too, don't pull. To breathe. Inhale. And on the exhale, I hope you wore your deodorant. Turn your nose into your underarm. Take a deep inhale. And exhale. Spine, and then exhale
down again.
And then we're going to inhale and sweep our arms back up. And exhale, prayer hands to chest. Again, inhale. Exhale. Inhale, look up. Exhale, forward fold. Sweep the arms up. Inhale. And exhale to chest. One more. We're going with each breath here. Inhale. Exhale. Inhale, look up. Exhale, forward fold. Now sweep the arms up. Inhale. And exhale. You just did your first little sun salutation for the day. We're going to bring our elbows down to our knees. You can press outward if you'd like. You can spread your legs out further if you need a deeper stretch, but just, you know, listen to your body. We're just going to hold here and take a few deep breaths. Make sure your spine is nice and straight. Then we're going to inhale and we're going to turn and twist to one side and look up at the ceiling, pressing our elbow into the opposite knee. Very good. Inhale, bring it to the center. And exhale to the other side. Inhale to the center. And exhale to the other side. Inhale and exhale. Inhale and exhale. You can roll your spine up back to a seated position. Now we're going to bring it back up for body now. And you're going to extend your feet out in front of you until your heels are resting on the floor. You're going to lean your body back. Don't use the chair. You're just going to lean it back and hold using your abs. We're going to bring our hands forward. We're just going to pump a little bit here. And if that's too much for you, you can bring your feet down if you need the extra assistance. Keep on pumping. Don't forget to breathe. This is modified Pilates in a chair. One day you're going to be like this. Like Rhett. Show off in the back.
Just, I've never tried it before.
And bring it down. You feel it in your abs?
Yeah,
and your shoulders?
It's
just been all over. We're going to do another round. But this time, come up here. We're going to pump here. 2, 3, 4, 5. Out. 2, 3, 4, 5. In. And out. Keep breathing. And in. Out. And in. And you can release. I'm sure you felt that one. We have one more round, so let's take a deep inhale and exhale together. Bring those feet out. Now this one, we're going to bring our arms up, we're going to lean back, and then we're going to come up and bring our arms up, and then we're going to come back, and then up, and then back, and up. Now we're going to add a little feature. We're going to go back, out, in, up, down, out, in, and up. All this ab work is going to keep you from falling. Get that strong core and lower back. Let's do two more of these, okay? Last one. You're doing great. Up and down. Now we just worked out our abs and some of our lower back there, so let's do a quick twist.
to unhinge a little bit. Exhale, bring it back to the center and switch. Mainly from the waist up so far. We're going to move it on down now, okay? So we're going to take our left foot and rest the heel on the ground just like that. And let's keep our sit bone. You're on the edge, but I want you to be still firmly on the chair so that you don't slide off when we move forward. And you're going to keep a straight spine. And we're just going to roll down that front leg. If you can reach your toe, awesome, and wrap around it, awesome. Remember to keep deep breathing. A lot of times when we're exercising, we hold our breath, and that's not a good thing. So keep breathing. Really stretch that hamstring and the calf. Try to go just a little bit deeper into the stretch, just a little bit. This is really great if you have sciatica pain as well.
What's that?
It's a nerve connected to your lower back, and it runs all the way down your leg. Sometimes it can get irritated by tightness. And you can just roll up.
And I'm sure Rhett can give us even more information on that kind of stuff. And bring that one down. Now taking the underbelly of this, let's roll it, lubricate. And outward. Direction so we can hike it. Whoop! It's my secret to getting it up there.
It works.
It does. Let's straighten our backs and exhale, bring it forward.
belly breaths into the stretch. Exhale, try to take it one more inch further. Then on the inhale, just roll the spine up.
Very good. And release. That was good.
Yes.
Now we're going to take our hands on our hips now. Now that our legs are nice and warmed up, we're going to extend our left leg, engaging the thigh here, and we're going to rotate our ankles and go the other direction. And if you didn't have shoes on, you spread your toes out really far. And then release. Other side, bring it up. Let's rotate. Rhett's going to talk about how important foot health is in preventing falls. I'm sure you all know that. Spread the toes out and bring it down. Now we're just going to do a light exercise. Engage the thigh and bring it down. Engage the thigh and bring it down. Just keep alternating. Just make sure you really squeeze in that quadricep when you come up. You didn't know you were coming for a workout today, did you?
I was hoping I was. I'm going to try. It's good.
Let's do five more. Five. Four. Three. Two. And one. Okay, ladies. Now we're going to stand up. And gent. Sorry. We're going to stand up. And you're going to get behind the chair. I'm going to move mine so that you can see the camera. And what we're going to do, starting up here, we're going to inhale. And we're just going to exhale and walk our feet back until our spine is parallel to the floor. This will be our modified downward dog. Take some deep breaths. You should feel a release in your shoulders, some in your spine. And on the inhale, I want you to come up, slightly walk forward, and bring your left foot to the chair. We're just going to bend our knee. Now, if you have a wall, you can push the chair up against the wall so you can really, if you want to get a deeper calf stretched out of that. Inhale. And what we're going to do is we're going to bring our arms up. Turn our back foot out. You can bring your hand down to the chair if you need it. Bring the hand back. The front hand forward until we are in a warrior two pose. Lovely. Hold it here. And we're going to inhale and bring the arms up. And exhale. We're going to inhale. And exhale. And one more. And exhale. Hold it here. Two, three. Bring the hands down to the chair. And bring it back up. Now, like I said, for balance,
Everything we do on one side, we do on the other. So let's inhale and walk our way back until we have a flat back into our downward dog. Deep breaths. On the inhale, we're going to come up and bring our right foot forward this time. Engaging our calf, there you go. Very good. Let's bring our arms up. Resting our right hand down, turning our back foot out. Beautiful. And just gazing out over your front hand there. Good. Let's inhale up. Exhale down. Inhale up. Exhale down. And inhale. And exhale, hold it, 2, 3, 4, bring the hands down, back up. Beautiful job. We're going to turn to one side, okay? You're all on the same side as me, except for you. So we're going to take our right foot, okay, now we're all on the same side. We're going to take our right foot and cross it over our left. We're going to really open our chest up and bring our arm out. And bring it up over our body and try to jut this hip out. And you'll feel a deep side body stretch. Feel that, yeah. Take a deep inhale. And exhale, bring it down. Turn the other side. So this time our left foot comes over our right. Really open that chest like we're ballerinas. Bring it up over the head. I hear someone moaning.
The youngest one here.
True.
Inhale. And exhale, bring it down. Now, I'm gonna teach y'all a trick that I'm sure you looked at it in newspapers, or in the newspapers, I don't have newspapers anymore, in magazines and said, I can't do that. You're gonna do the tree pose today. So, we're gonna take one hand on our chair. We wanna talk about balance. You have to practice by balancing. So we're gonna put a hand on our hip here. We're going to bring up our right knee. Just bring it up until you feel stable on that left foot. Then we're going to turn our knee out and rest the foot on our calf. Yep. Yep. Everybody got it? If you feel comfortable, you can release your hands and actually give your tree some branches. But you just might be a stump in the floor. That's okay. Look at these beautiful trees. And hold it here. Try to take a deep breath. And exhale, bring your branches down. Bring the knee forward with control. And release. There you did it. Other side. Hand on the hip, hand on the chair. Let's bring the left knee up. And then just turn it out and place the foot on our calf. If you feel comfortable, you can give your tree some branches. Deep inhale. And exhale, bring the branches down, turn the knee in, and release with control. Come back in front now. I know, I've worked you out, so let's bring it down a notch. back in your chair. So we're going to get completely relaxed. Let's do one inhale, arms come up. Exhale down. Inhale, come up. Exhale down. One more. Inhale. And exhale down. Rest your hands on your thighs. Close your eyes. Begin to lose yourself in your breath. Relax your forehead, your eyelids, your ears. Release your tongue from the roof of your mouth. Relax your neck, your collarbone, your shoulders, elbows, wrists, and fingers. Relax your belly, your hips, your thighs, your knees, ankles, and toes. Imagine your body sinking into the earth. Mind, whatever thoughts come in, embrace them, take them in for just a minute, and then release them. Slowly begin to wiggle your fingers and your toes. You can bring your hands out to your sides and rotate your ankles and wrists. Then finding your breath again, let's take a deep inhale and bring our arms up overhead. And exhale. Namaste.
Namaste.
Thank you for practicing with me
today.
Thank you. Yeah, man, I really like that.
I think Rhett is now going to come up.
Yes. And quickly, I wanted to say that Karina Harmon is the herbalist for next month.
That's what I meant. Harmon.
Yes. Yeah. That is who it is.
Her website is.
And also, Laura Park is in the back from Get Fit, and she is here if anybody's interested in finding out about the Silver Sneakers program, and you can qualify to see if you can qualify for free even for that membership. So, welcome, Rhett.
Good morning. Good morning. I'm just gonna use this. So you've already heard my spiel, right?
I brought that just for you.
Thank you. Did you really?
Yes. I got a new marker.
Yeah, I guess you couldn't see the last one, huh? All right. See if I can
relax. I've
forgotten all of it by now. See if I can accomplish what I want to accomplish this morning.
Alrighty. Have I met these folks before?
No.
I don't think so.
Here, you want to look at this?
Yes, please.
Just leave a stack. You actually need one. So I got to write a few things on the board. Try to write big.
No, I'm trying to get her attention.
So I don't know how to spell this word.
Commandeer.
Is that how you spell that? That doesn't look right. Anyways, we'll talk about that in just a second.
Okay, we don't need it.
I'm a big reader, so because of that, I'm a pretty good speller, but I don't know that I've ever tried to spell that word, so I don't remember.
It doesn't matter.
C-O-M-M-O-N. You spell it.
I-E-R.
It could be
A-N-D. It's A-N-D-E-R.
D-E-R, okay, perfect. Just like this, C-O-M-M. Oh, sweet. Okay, great.
Is
that you recognize.
My cell phone's in my car.
Yeah,
check it.
Two E's. D-E-E-R.
You added that part.
All right.
There you go. You were close.
Thank you. Loved it.
I gave my information back there if anybody needs it.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
See us. I'm really impressed with yoga. I just started yoga this year.
I like that the best.
I'm sorry?
I like what we just did the best.
Yeah. Yeah, actually, that's why I was going to, you guys know what the word commandeer means. It has to do with stealing, you know, someone else's ideas. Or stealing someone else's. And the whole point of me writing that is because I try to keep in mind every book that I read or every class I take or seminar I take, you know, you can't take everything. There's just too much information out there. I read a lot on, you know, a lot of articles. There's all kind of, it's kind of amazing how much information is out there nowadays, especially related to healthcare, you know, and how things are changing. It's hard to keep up with.
Right.
And but if you are committed to, I want to challenge you to commit to taking something from every experience you have. So that would be like today. You know, we had an experience this morning of a little bit of yoga. Take some of that with you. How easy is this to do, right? All you need is your chair or no chair. And you can take this stuff with you. There's no reason why you couldn't go to Silver Sneakers, the Silver Sneakers class, or go to yoga sessions and then practice some of the stuff that you learn at home, right? They're based on Silver Sneakers. I used to be a Silver Sneaker instructor, by the way, for YMCA, and I loved it. We're gonna talk about how important exercise is to maintain health. You know, it's really what I consider brain food. You think about the whole science of nutrition, okay? And biochemistry, you know, AKA biochemistry, and you go through med school and you have to learn all this biochemical information, how our cells work and how they work with each other, and the whole life cycle of cells. By the way, the life cycle of a nerve cell, you know how long the life cycle of a nerve cell is?
24 hours.
120 years. What's the life cycle of a blood cell? 120 days. So not, you know, we have 100 trillion cells, estimated 100 trillion cells. Not all of them operate by the same principles or by the same rules, right? They're governed by genetic information. That genetic information dictates their lifespan or their life cycles. Anyways, we're going to talk about nerve cells and how, basically, so why am I here? I'm here to validate what we've just been through and how exercise might play into a chiropractor's role to keep someone healthy, and how chiropractor maybe can help someone exercise in a way that is better. Actually, I was going to write something else. Improved performance. Efficiency. Okay, so these would be reasons why you should look for opportunities or try to experience different exercise opportunities, and or come go see a chiropractor. Actually, you'd think maybe they're not related, but so I'm here to not talk about chiropractic the entire time, but I am here to spend a little bit of time talking about trying to clear the air. A lot of people don't know, you know, they just think chiropractors are back doctors. In the old days, we were actually called bone setters. People don't understand necessarily what chiropractic is all about, but it is under the umbrella of complementary and alternative medicine. I'll get into that. You know, even exercise is considered. By the way, thank you so much for being here, Get Fit. I am a huge proponent of that gym, and a huge proponent of Silver Sneakers and classes like Silver Sneakers. Do we have Silver Sneakers in Berea?
I think they're probably...
We have other opportunities that are similar to Silver Sneakers, but the point is we're going to talk about why looking for opportunities to exercise is so important. We, you know, between Berea, Richmond, Lexington, you should have never, there's nothing, you know, you couldn't find, you know. Anyways, I gave you some little information about myself. I am a chiropractor in Berea. My business card is there. We're going to talk about the white piece of white paper which I put together, and then I started a club in Berea, and I didn't start the company called Urban Ninja Project. I'm going to give this to Miss Get Fit back there because she's looking like, what is that? You bet. So I didn't start the company, but I'm affiliated with the company. I'm now a trainer. I've got a couple certifications now that they paid for, actually, for me to be associated with them and teach classes and that sort of thing. My goal as a doctor, you know, I see a primary issue with doctors, and that is, and I hope it drives you up a wall just as much as it does me, but when doctors don't take their own medicine, you know, you get doctors that preach one thing and do another, you know, and you got a lot of complementary alternative doctors or naturopathic doctors that are very unhealthy. Chiropractors, notoriously known to not live any longer than anybody else, you know, and it drives me up a wall. So what is the, you know, what is the issue like? I went to chiropractic school, which is not med school, but very similar to med school. And you've got students that are committed to partying more than studying. You know, we have some fundamental issues, right, associated with healthcare. And I don't want to be that. I want to be the doctor that, you know, teaches yoga on Saturdays or teaches parkour during the week or teaches silver sneakers. Why couldn't I do that? You know, why shouldn't I do that? I'm certainly, you know, certainly if it fits this model of why exercise would be so important. Anyways, I'm very practical. So in terms of falling prevention and efforts we take to try to fix this issue, which is costing our country more than billions of dollars we're spending on healthcare issues related to falls. And when I left chiropractic school, my Logan University, the school I graduated from, in St. Louis, Missouri, they had got a multi-million dollar grant to provide research associated with this issue in our country, falls prevention. What's going on? What's the issue here? You know, why are we spending so much money during the year on falls? Why are people falling? So anyways, I contacted a physical therapist who works with fall rehab or fall victims. She rehabs fall victims. And looked a little bit at the research, but there's so much research out there. And, you know, basically, if you want to research fall and prevention, you can do just a very quick Google search, and it'll come up. You know, you'll see how much money we're spending, number one. And, you know, I don't know that they necessarily provide many solutions, but they've got a lot of information related to, you know, if you're 80 years old and you fall, you know, obviously it's a more serious, it could be, the potential for it being a more serious issue is there, versus that if you're 65 and you fell, you know, most likely you're going to recover, or you have this, you know, this percentage of recovering from that particular fall, or, you know, stuff like that, you know. So we have a lot of data related to it, but I have some practical information, which you can pass on if it doesn't really, you know, if it doesn't relate to you guys. But my practical tips, you didn't get practical tips. I'm sorry. I think I might have ran out. Okay. Yeah. I'll give this to you real quick so you are with us. But clear path to the bathroom. So. Apparently the most common type, according to this physical therapist, the most common time that she sees, or the most common story as far as the narrative of the people that she's seeing, the most common time people are falling is when they're trying to get to the bathroom in the middle of the night or early in the morning. So she had some really good suggestions that she gives her clients, and that is to find like a motion sensor light, which I think is which is number two there, lights and motion sensors you can find at Home or Lowe's. You just kind of have like an adhesive sticky part and you just stick it on the wall, you know, and it lights up the path on the way. Also declutter, where do I have declutter? Clear path to the bathroom, whether you go in the middle of the night or in the morning. So make sure that you have some sort of, at least have a clear path to the bathroom so that you're not tripping over things. Lights and motion sensors, if you need it. Eyesight, we'll talk in just a second. Number four is fluorescent tapes. Another, I should have had that as number three. I think that makes more sense. But it's something else we could use, you know, to make our environment a little more perceivable if you're having eyesight issues. You can, you know, they make really fancy fluorescent tapes that you can, that, you know, that will give you a better judgment of distance of the floor or walls, whatever you can. This particular physical therapist recommended that she put stuff like on stairs, you know, at the bottom of stairs, or that, you know, so that they know where they're going. Physical therapists are pretty amazing too. They've got all kind of ideas. Eyesight. So eyesight, put eyesight on there because eyesight, at the very foundational or fundamental issues associated with eyesight have to do with metabolism and nutrition. So chronic diseases, autoimmune issues, you know, if you study those diseases, they end up, you know, think of diabetes, they end up having eyesight issues. So if you feel like you're losing eyesight, if your eyesight's, feel like something's, your eyesight's getting worse, whatever, think about a nutritional component, some sort of something you need to do from a nutritional standpoint, or dietary standpoint. Eating better, you know, people tend to think like, you know, as we age, we can get away with more, but the I think the truth of it is, as we, you know, everything sort of tends to degenerate, right? We're in this whole, the world we live in is degenerating, right? This whole concept of entropy, we're going from a state of organization to a state of disorganization that includes us as humans. And, you know, as we age, we degenerate. It's a natural part of life, but we don't necessarily, you know, and I actually have a blog, and I'll put my blog website. It's not on, I have a website, a blog. Anyways, they're not connected. But anyway, that's a poor business stuff. Anyways, all that to say, I wrote something on my blog about this very issue. And I can't remember what we were just talking about. What were we just talking about?
The idea of entropy and
entropy. And degeneration. You know, everyone's degenerating at a different rate. You know, people don't degenerate in the same rate, in the same way. You know, different diseases, different problems, all that to say, we can't necessarily predict what people are going to come down with, but that's why we do our best to live our lives in the most healthy way possible, so that hopefully you can outlive disease. Phil Maffetone is one of my favorite authors, and he talks about outliving disease, you know, pushing it, you know, getting lifestyle habits so in tune that you push disease processes past 120 years so that you end up outliving it. And I love that idea. I don't know if it's possible for me. I hope that it is. But, a lot of that, in terms of, you know, complementary alternative medicine, really, and the medical field, the allopathic model, the conventional model, really hates when we start talking about prevention. Chiropractic as preventative medicine, or anything other than their product as prevention. You know, they call chemotherapy as preventative medicine, or whatever they're pushing. Statin drugs as preventative medicine, even Tylenol and Ibuprofen, all the over-the-counter stuff, Advil, as preventative. And it doesn't fit our definition, so we're not necessarily on the same page, but yet we're, from a legal standpoint, we're asked to try to work well together. It gets pretty hard. The alternative mindset, we're faced with two different paradigms. So, and from my point of view, from the alternative naturalistic medicine point of view, our paradigm really is based on this whole idea of vix medicatrix naturale, which is a Latin term for the healing power of nature. So the, you know, living things, natural things have a way of restoring themselves right over time. You cut your hand or whatever, and it heals. It might take, depends on how, you know, the seriousness of that particular cut, or, you know, you're in an accident. This whole idea of you know, some sort of brain injury, you know, and there are plenty of stories of people that being a traumatic event and people not recovering, and there's plenty of stories of people recovering from that sort of stuff. How does that happen, you know? lifestyle has a big to do with that whole stuff. So my Let's see, did I finish? Let me finish this real quick. So exercise daily, we're going to talk about more of that and why that is important. Basically, if you remember nothing else, common to your mind, this idea, and that is that look for opportunities to be active. If, whether that's a fall and prevention workshop, or a yoga class, silver sneakers, or other services they provide at Get Fit, or that's one of the reasons why I put this in here is to show you guys of another opportunity. It's not necessarily for adults, but we wouldn't turn any adults away. It's for kids. We started it. Basically, I wanted to promote this whole idea of not all doctors are just sitting in offices and waiting for patients to walk in the door. Some of us are very active in our communities. I'm starting two clubs, me and a friend of mine. We started this one for kids, exercise opportunities for kids, and also a fermentation group, which is we're starting next month. The whole idea of it being that gut health is pervades all other systems of the body, including brain function, and fermenting vegetables specifically is a necessity in every household, we feel like, and that's the message that club is always, what that's going to be about. So just another opportunity. Look for opportunities. So this whole idea of neurodevelopment, especially in kids, kids develop very, very, within that first year, their nervous systems and their system, their whole bodies in general are, it's almost like you can almost see them develop on a daily basis, or see changes from one day within 24 hours in certain aspects. And then we slow down and we don't change as much. But in terms of neural capacity, in terms of our ability from an intelligence standpoint, I'm going to present an argument for why you couldn't, you have this amazing capacity to store information and you can never fill it. In a million years, you wouldn't be able to fill the storehouses you have, the capacity, the hardware, basically, of being able to store information. So, you could read a book a day or whatever for the rest of your life and still not exceed your ability to learn. And Einstein, I love this quote from Einstein, learning is experience, everything else is just knowledge. Look for experiences, learning is doing. Learning can be doing. I love to read, but I also love to do. So look for opportunities. So this whole idea of neurodevelopment depends on experience. Experience depends on opportunity. So this morning we had an opportunity to learn a little bit of chair yoga, and you took advantage because you're here, right? And we had a great teacher, and I'm hoping that you will listen to my advice and take some of the stuff. And 5 minutes, 5 minutes a day, would certainly change things. Could certainly change cognitive function. You don't need much. You don't need much to make a difference, and that's the point. Neurodevelopment depends on experience. So we had an experience this morning, right? So that aids in our staying healthy. Neurodevelopment. What's the payoff of neurodevelopment? These three things: improve performance around the house or out in general public, improve movement efficiency. You're gonna this whole idea of neurodevelopment actually improves your ability to move, and move at a reduced metabolic cost. That's a big part of what I do and what I teach from a chiropractic standpoint. Movement is life, right? All living things maintain six characteristics. If you're alive, you maintain these six characteristics, and one of them is movement. All living things have a metabolism. All living things are able to respond to a stimulus. All living things are grow. All living things differentiate cells. All living things reproduce. All living things move. So I love Covert Bailey's. Have you guys heard of Covert Bailey? Fit or Fat? He was a MIT biochemist, and he presented this whole, the first time I had ever heard it, but he presented this whole argument of the whole idea. If you're not in tune with nutrition, you're going to start hearing that the medical field is in trouble. And I'll tell as things are, and we need them and that sort of thing. But they've been promoting this whole idea of fat as an issue for a long time, but from it doesn't meet the science. From a biochemical standpoint, we get more energy per gram of fat than carbs, at least 2.25 times, and as much as 13 times more 13 times more energy per gram of fat than sugar. Right. So that would be, that whole conversation is a conversation related to metabolic disease and things like diabetes and that sort of thing. So if you hear this, you're going to be starting hearing this more and more, because the things are, trends are changing. They're not willing, you know, this whole idea. Ansel Adams was the big guy with the big study. He called it the 7 countries study, and he promoted this whole idea of fat being an issue, and saturated fat being an issue, and they're on, you know, and thus this propagating this idea for years and years and years. But it doesn't meet the science.
Is that where they talk about now, about the things that have the good fats, like alcohol?
Good fats and bad fats. So you're already on top of it. Good fats and bad fats, right? You've heard of this. I just read a book by Johnny Bowman, if you guys have heard of Johnny Bowman. He wrote a book called Smart Fat with another doctor. And they're still not willing to, he's a naturopath, or I think one's a medical doctor, and the other, Johnny Bowman I don't even know what his credentials were, but he's written a lot of books, and he's a nutritionist, I think. But they're still not willing to say saturated fat is a good thing, but they're not, now they're switching to, it's no longer a bad thing. They call it a neutral dietary substance, or something that's neutral. We have foods that are bad, foods that are neutral, are not beneficial nor negative, and then foods that are beneficial. So good, bad, and then neutral. I don't think you could say that. I don't know how you say from any scientific point of view that some sort of food is neutral. I don't understand that. But they're still not willing to jump on, because no one wants to be liable. We're still sort of depending on science to sort of make the conclusive remarks of, yeah, okay, fats are okay, or saturated fats are still not, you know, are not creating a problem. I just watched you guys on Facebook at all? You're not on Facebook? Anyways, so a lot of us younger folks, are you on Facebook?
I am.
And are you on Facebook?
Everybody's on Facebook with me.
If you don't,
it helps your blood pressure much, you're on Facebook.
I agree.
What, it helps spike your blood pressure, is that what you said?
It helps if you're not.
Yeah, certainly there's a lot of issues related to social media and that sort of thing. But anyways, you can also learn a lot.
That's why
you can learn a lot.
$2 million, that's why I'm not. I don't, and I find that that's a waste of my time.
It is a hole. Yeah.
If I've got to look and see what somebody else is doing, I'm not doing something.
Well, my point was that this was, you can learn, you can pick up on information, you know, you can pick up on trends.
Yeah.
And I, just this morning, I, you know, there was somebody else, it was a doctor, I'd never heard of her before, but a doctor, Merritt, I think, was her name. She's promoting the same idea of fats not being an issue like we thought. So anyways, just listen for trends, okay? That's the point. So before we go, because I know we're out of time, I brought a lot of things, and I am a type of speaker who doesn't have it all together, basically. I even wrote out a speech, but I never follow my rubric, you know, so I apologize. But anyways, all that to say, neural development. So as far as nerve cells go, I'll leave you this with this. We have about 10 to the 23rd, somewhere estimated, you know, it's hard to say. I would never want to give like a definite answer, but we have somewhere between about 10 to the 23rd power nerve cells in our body. Okay, that's a lot. They say it's the number of stars in our galaxy is how they describe that. So I drew a couple nerve cells. There was a really famous medical doctor, neurologist from Mexico, and he lived in the early 20th century, and he's the one that discovered the shape and the typical shape and sizes and the different characteristics of nerve cells. And this is what he drew. He's got slides that he created and stuff. And I think he's got pictures. Even they became some sort of artistic gallery, I think. Anyways, this is what nerve cells look like. We have what's called dendrites. a nucleus in the middle. That's what that little O, that little circle is. And then an axon. These axons are what, basically, the way that nerve cells are shaped. We have this side, the dendrites, which receive information, and this side, which purports information. So we have a receiving end, and then a side of the, can you see this?
Yeah.
And then a
yeah.
side of the neuron that basically projects that information, or keeps the information flowing, right? These guys connect with each other. So they send little branches to each other. Sometimes they even connect to themselves. So there's all these connections. Now the connections, the number of connections for any one neuron is somewhere between 1,000 and 10,000 times. So you've got this many neurons connecting between 1,000 and 10,000 times a piece. Those are projections. Who knows really how many, but anyways, it's a lot. The whole point is, if I drew another nerve cell, however that guy's shaped, right? The whole idea of this learning. So you think about brushing your hair, brushing your teeth, combing your hair, even walking, right? There's this guy named Erwin Kaur. And he says, in the same way that your thumbprint is a representation of you and nobody else, just like they can take fingerprints and stuff down at the police station and identify you through a thumbprint, we can identify, he says, in a better way, we can identify you by the way that these nerve cells fire. So the way that you walk, you know, noticed this? You can identify someone from 100 yards away, 200 yards away even, just by the way they walk. Have you ever done that? You've identified someone from a distance, right? And you certainly couldn't have seen a thumbprint. It's a way that characterizes you, the way that you move. Okay, and you move in a way that no one else does, which is interesting. That's what this guy says. These neurons fire at a rate, at a time, at a rhythm, and in a pattern that characterizes you, that matches you, your personality. And this is a way, the way that these guys connect is a way that's going to keep you safe. It keeps you injury-free. Okay, your ability to do sun salutations, or your ability to do, you know, a hop and a skip or something, is dependent on certain neurons firing, and firing in a certain pattern. Same way with the way you walk, okay? Neurons fire in a certain way, right? Neurons fire in a certain way to activate muscles, and activate muscles in a certain way. Some of this stuff can get screwed up, though, and that's where I come in as a chiropractor. This is what I fix. So I know we have to go, because I'll just do a very, very simple, our nervous systems, I'll do a very, very simple analogy, and then I'll go, because I didn't get to do this last time. I was so excited about this, and I've talked.
Well, it's because you're new at this, you know, and as time goes by, you'll be, this is very interesting to me.
Yeah, and I recommend books by Norman Dodge, if you want to learn more about this. Norman Dodge, The Brain's Way of Thinking, and then he wrote that was his second book, and then his first book is called The Brain That Changes Itself. It's all about this is called neuroplasticity, the way that neurons connect and work with each other. He came up with a term in his book, neurons that fire together, wire together. And this whole wiring, this whole networking, it's kind of like having neighbors and having friends. These guys, they end up connecting in a way that keeps you safe, that propagates certain movements where you're, you know, I'm sure you guys have stepped off of a curb and not necessarily known there was some sort of drop. Mm-hmm. Right? How does your nervous system recover?
Oh.
Right? It's because it has a way of correcting itself and sort of adapting to certain things, and it's all based on nervous system function. So, anyways, let me do this real quick, and then we'll go. Our nervous system would work a lot like the game of Clue. Have you guys played the game of Clue?
Yeah.
Sure.
Basically. So in the game of Clue, you have, you know, you might be a, um, who's one of them, Mrs. Peacock or whoever. And the whole point is to see who, at the end of the game, it's a murder mystery, so you're trying to figure out who killed who with whom, or who with what and in what room, right? You go around the board. Have you played it before? You go around the, it's a murder mystery, so you go around the board collecting evidence, collecting information. That evidence is analogous to our cranial nerves, our special senses, ability to see, nose, ears, your vestibular system or your balance system, your ability to taste, different, you know, thousands and thousands of receptors on your skin detecting pressure and vibration, and that sort of thing. So this is the evidence. So you go around in the game, you go around collecting evidence, and then you make an educated guess. The more evidence you have, the better the educated guess, right? So you need to collect information. Well, this is how our nervous systems work, right? There's actually a mathematical component to this too. If I have one in the game, right, you can make an educated guess at any whenever it becomes your turn, whether or not you have all the evidence or not, right? You could say, I could just guess and say, okay, I only have two pieces of evidence, but I think Mary's going to win the game, so I might as well go ahead and just guess to try to win the game. So, all that to say that, forgot my train of thought. Anyways, you collect evidence. That's the whole point of the game, right? And our nervous system works in the very same fashion. We're collecting evidence in terms of our ability to see, hear. You know, you take some of that evidence away, and you tend you're going to end up degenerating a lot faster. Number one, and number two is you'd be less safe and that sort of thing, because you cannot. You know, health. One measure of health is the perception of the world around you. Well, how do we do that? We do that with our special senses. We do that with the receptors in our skin. We do that with, you know, I was going to talk about shoes a little bit. One of the issues with shoes is that the higher you are off the ground. So I would really encourage you guys to look at barefoothub.com, Society of Barefoot Living, and to commit to, is what I tell all my patients, to commit to less shoe rather than more. And the reason for that is the higher you are off the ground, the less you maintain contact with the ground. That can be a real problem. And I think that's a major issue in this fall prevention. I only bring it up because I think it's a real issue, not only in people's health, but also in this fall prevention related topic. I'll just leave with that. We talked a lot about that last time, more than I wanted to, but anyways, I'm very passionate about shoes. It has a huge effect on people's health. It has a huge effect on their system function. So that's why. Anyways, okay, so what I was going to do is bring a couple pieces of evidence here. So I have like a cup. If I gave this lady a cup, could you tell me what our next activity is?
Or
you know, it could be
or something in it.
You know, you would automatically assume, okay, we're probably going to be drinking something. If I gave you a tea bag. Okay, you're thinking, okay, yeah, that really meets the evidence, so that really matches my previous experience even. You know, give her a cup, give her a tea bag, she automatically knows. Now if I give her water, she knows, okay, yeah, definitely I think that the next, so, you know, in other words, and I had more things. I had a plate and a napkin and silverware, and I had a letter, an envelope, and a pen that I would hand someone else. The point is, the more evidence you have, the better educated guess you can make. Our nervous systems depend on information to make predictions about our environment in a way that's going to keep us safe, in a way that's going to keep us healthy. So sometimes I get screwed up. That's where I come in. And I don't do it through adjusting the spine. I do it through other means. But one of the things about adjusting the spine or correcting subluxations is it has an ability to correct, to enhance the perception around you. So, and it all has to do with normalizing your ability to receive information. That's a big, big deal, and it's a big deal that shoes can interfere with, and that's why I might bring up shoes in the whole conversation. All that to say, okay, I'll leave you with this. We don't support dysfunction with biotechnology, stuff like knee braces. You can, right? But what I want to encourage you to do is support it or stabilize or... we don't support, I forgot my own term. We don't support dysfunction with biotechnology. We support it with exercise. Oh, we wrap it. That's what I say. We wrap it with exercise. We wrap joints with exercise. Basically, and it all has to do with this. So our ability to network, our nervous system's function's ability to network. I'll leave you with this idea. Any physiology textbook, any exercise physiology textbook, you go to Get Fit, you start talking to them about exercise and all that sort of thing, they'll tell you, right, and this is very well researched, very well documented, the first gains you will make all have to do with coordination, right? You'll end up, people end up plateauing, they work for a little bit, work for a while, you do yoga for a month, and you notice, hey, I'm making some strength gains. I'm getting stronger because I'm doing these activities, right? Or you commit to running 3 times a week for a month or whatever you think. Hey, I'm getting better at this, right? The first gains that you'll make ever, and this is always true, is always it's a coordination between your ability to, basically it's a neuroplasticity issue. It's these nerve cells being able to pattern and network together to get you to coordinate certain activities like yoga. It's the first thing. After that, once the patterns are super solidified and you're really operating at a more coordinated effort than you were before, then you start making the muscle hypertrophy. They end up, muscles start getting bigger, and your lactic acid thresholds start decreasing, increasing, and your ability to breathe starts getting better and all that sort of thing. But the first thing that has to happen in exercise is this, neuroplasticity, is the ability for your nervous system, your nerve cells to network together. Anyways, I gave you a lot, yes. And I wrote a lot up here. What you need to remember is look for opportunities. Look for opportunities. Opportunities will provide the experience to get the neurodevelopment that's gonna improve quality of life and hold quality of life together. Is it gonna be, I mean, I don't know anybody that's, you know, that hasn't died, so we're all going somewhere, but all that to say, that thanks so much for being here. Sorry I talked so long.